Each team has 13 hits in this ball game. Now there's a little movement in the Cub bullpen. Looks like Crosby's going to get up. There's a ball. Ball one. Action in the bullpen. That's a ball. Ball one. Outfield straight away, fairly deep. The Candlestick Park wind has given those outfielders a real fit on a few occasions today. Took one away from Monday, almost took one away from Morales. Embarrassed Joshua for a three baser when he thought it was going to be shorter than it was. There he goes. There's a ground ball. Bouncing to Trio. Tags his man. Throws to first. Got the double play. Montanez tagged. Reached doubled up. Well, it's about time the Cubs got one of those. The Giants have had four of those DPs today. So Ken Reach bounced the ball right at Matty Trio. Montanez couldn't slow up in time to slow that play up. So he was a dead duck. On the 4-3 double play, eased the pressure quite a bit. Joshua the batter. Von Joshua. Strike one. Boy, he went for a pitch that was beyond the end of his bat that time. Strike one. Strike. Foul ball. 0-2. Two out. A no ball. Strike two count. Foul ball. Von Joshua hitless today in five at-bats. And he's 1-for-12 in the series. Giants have had their problems with offense this year. 0-2. Oh, he went for a curveball and struck out, and that retires the side. No runs, one hit, no errors. Nobody left at the end of 12. The score at Candlestick in game one is still the Cubs 5, the Giants 5.
Shows the Cubs with 5 runs, 13 hits. The Giants, 5 runs, 13 hits. The Cubs have had 3 extra outs. So now Frailing, hoping to get 3 more outs here in the bottom of the 13th. He will face Sadik, the catcher, and then the pitcher, Lavelle, and then the top of the order, Thomas. Sadik had one time at bat and grounded out to Rosello. He's a right-handed hitter. Cubs and the Giants battling, and when they get together, they battle one way or the other. Strike one call. Giants, I believe, had a 16-inning game here with the Cardinals last week. Frailing on the mound, the pitch, curveball, strike call, a beauty. You can see that baby break right over the plate very sharply. And two pitch inside. Frailing is the fourth Cub pitcher to work in this first game. Giants have used five, and we have another game after this one. There's a swing and a fly ball to center field. This should be easy for Monday. He's there, runs to his left and grabs it for the out. One away, and Gary Lavelle will bat. This fellow, as a pitcher, has yet to allow a run to be scored. He's 1-0 in the won and lost department. There's the curveball that breaks low. So you can see why Rigney made the decision to go with him. He's his hot man right now. There's a strike. It's 1-1. There is Thomas, the leadoff hitter. And he, of course, switch hitter, will bat right-handed against the southpaw Frailing. Outside to the pitcher. Ball two, strike one. We don't want to lose this fellow. Make him hit his way on. We're all tied up 5-5. Low ball three. We are in the 13th inning. There's Bobby Winkles giving a sign. One of those maneuvers will mean something to Lavelle. It meant take, and he did, and it's now it's 3-2. Doesn't have to look down for a sign here on the 3-2 pitch. On its way. Ground ball to the trio's right. It's past him into center field for a base hit. Well, he's hot. Not only pitching and batting.
It's a good thing he didn't do that the last time he was at bat. The game would be over.
And he was swinging. He was hanging tough. Now, the top of the order. Lavelle at first base with the winning run. And here's Thomas at bat. Second hit off Frailing, 14 in total for the Giants. Frailing will look right at Lavelle, and Lecoq is holding him on first base. Thomas checks his swing. They ask for an appeal. Mirrorwall says it tipped his bat. And the appeal is given to the Cubs. Wire said yes, he did go around. Strike one. Frailing is ready, checks the runner at first. Thomas pops it foul. Strike two to Thomas. Lavelle, the pitcher, singles in the center field past the reach of Trio after Sadik flied out to Monday. So the Giants have a runner on first and one out. Frailing is ready to the 0-2 pitch to Thomas. He pops it foul near the dugout. No room as it lands right on top of the dugout. Minerwal doing the catching, replacing Hundley.
Swisher just sore, as it turns out. Fortunately, the x-rays were negative.
Good. It's a very delicate spot to get a foul ball right above the sternum. Line drive down the left field line. Curving. It's a foul ball.
Woo!
Foul ball. Winkles is jumping up in the air. Rigney is out of the dugout. A ball has been thrown on the field. A foul ball called by the third base umpire. That baby was close. That could have been the ball game. There's Rigney. In fact, Rigney is out farther in front of the dugout. Now he returns to his position in the corner. Winkles is still talking with the third base umpire. That could only be inches foul. Well, we won't. Don't do that again. Don't pitch that same pitch. Two strikes on Thomas. Crosby, a right-hander, warming up in the Cubs bullpen. Outside and low, ball one, strike two. Lavelle on first. One out. Tap down to the first baseman. Lecoq has it. Goes to second for the force. The speedster Thomas is safe at first. Now we have to keep an eye on Thomas with Spire at bat. Two outs. And we're in the 13th inning. Thomas had 28 stolen bases last year. He has speed. Now time is called. Spire's trotting back to get the rosin bag and take a look into the dugout. He wants to know what Rigney has in his mind as to hitting and running or letting the man attempt a steal. Spire stole second in the seventh off Hundley. Lecoq at first holding Thomas close. He has a tremendous lead. His right foot is on the carpet. Frailing into the stretch. Spire takes high, ball one. This is where a good base runner in this situation can worry a pitcher. Number one, he will try to release the ball too quickly to the plate and lose control or lose that little extra on his good fastball. Quick pitch to him. A pitch out. Ball two. Ball two, no strikes. Ken Frailing looking directly in for the sign. Now he'll look directly at Thomas. He does. Ball three. Frailing seems to be more concerned with Thomas than he is pitching to Spire. 3-0. Mercer due up next. A tough hitter due up next. There's a strike. 3-1 the count. He may be going for second base on this pitch. The run and hit may be on. A run and hit means that the hitter can swing at it if it's in the strike zone. If it's in the outside of the strike zone, take it. We'll watch Thomas. He's not going. There's a swing, a fly ball to left field. Cardinal there. Backs up. He has it. We go into the 14th inning. In the 13th, no runs, one hit, one man left on base at the end of 13. Complete innings, Cubs 5, Giants 5. Ken Frailing. There's Montanez holding Rozelle on at first, and Frailing, as he's walking to the plate, looking down to Dunlap, the coach, to get his sign. And now he wants to be sure. He wants to be sure, so he's going to trot down and have a talk. With this artificial turf, and with a third baseman and a first baseman charging from their respective positions, you almost have to put a perfect bunt down that either line to advance the man, or you must run and bunt. So we'll see how Marshall plays this. First pitch, instead he throws to first. Rosella's back. Thomas is playing very shallow, as if there was a man on third. He's playing only halfway in his position. Another throw to first, but Rosello's back safely. Reitz is playing in about 15 feet at third base and will creep in as the pitch is thrown. Here it is. There's the bunt down to first baseline, but foul. Normally, a left-hander will try to bunt down the first baseline because the first baseman has to remain just for that second at first. And he has to charge in very quickly. He doesn't know whether that pitcher is going to throw over there or not. There's Dunlap flashing another sign to Frailing. Frailing says he has it and steps in the batter's box. Oh, throw to first. Rosella was leaning, but he got back safely. Oh, let me tell you, he was leaning toward second base. Lavelle ready. There he goes on the button run. It's back to the pitcher. He looks at second base, cannot make the play, and throws to first for the out. Ken Frailing waiting for Mercer to step into the batter's box. Well, it's been a long time from the opening pitch of this first ball game, and we have another one to go. Let's hope the Cubs can keep that one run lead, make it hold up. Here's Mercer at bat.
Good evening, everybody. If I could have your attention for just 1 minute. We're not ready to start yet, but as you can tell, this room is filling up very quickly. If you could help us out, if there are seats in between you and the people next to you, could you fill those seats for us and create some more chairs on the ends of the rows for people that are still coming in? But we're also bringing in more chairs as we speak to create some more chairs. But if you could help us out and kind of squeeze in and create some extra chairs, that would be a big help. Thank you.
Fastball for a strike right down the middle. Mercer has three hits today. Curveball for a strike. That one broke very sharply down and over the plate. Two strikes on Mercer. He'll be followed by Matthews and then Montanez. 14th inning. Cubs lead 6-5. Brushed him back a little bit. Keeps him away from that plate. 1-2 the count. One and two pitch. That knocked his helmet back. It's 2-2. Well, now we'll see on this pitch whether Frailing and Mitterwald will call and Frailing throw a curveball. That is usually the procedure. There it is, curveball, but it's a base hit to center field. That shows you what type of a hitter Mercer was. He stayed right in there and singled to center field. He's the tying run, the lead and winning run at the plate in the person of Matthews.
Brigney has a good stagger to his batting order, hasn't he?
Yes, he has.
Leadoff switch hitter, then right, then left, right, left, right, left, right.
Crosby warming up in the Cubs bullpen. That's Matthews in the batter's box. First pitch. Swing and a miss as he was trying to put one out of this ballpark. Strike one to Matthews. Mercer with a lead at first, and he's fast. One and one to count. The pitch. Swinging a high chopper to Matlock. This will be tough. He goes to first. He has Matthews, but the tying run advances to second. He had only one play. Ball bouncing very high on that artificial turf. Here's Montanez at bat. Singled off of Frailing in the 12th inning. We're in the 14th. Ken Frailing in his first appearance since being taken off of the disabled list on the mound. Mercer with a lead at second base. Cubs are not paying any attention to him. They want to get the out. One out. The pitch. Low curveball, ball one. There's Mercer with his walking lead at second. Looks back at Trio and Rosello. See how far they are playing from him and the bag. Frailing's pitch to Montanez. Strike call, curveball. You have to outguess this man. He's quite a guess hitter. If he guesses right, he's tough. He'll go to the opposite field with you. And he'll pull a ball. He pulled a single into right field on Frailing in the 12th inning. Left-handed hitter. Good power. One and one pitch. Pop foul. One ball, two strikes. It's cloudy. Getting quite cloudy here and cool. Montanez levels a bat over the plate, then holds it right back on that back shoulder. Now Frailing taking a little too much time, so time is called. Mercer on second base with a tying run here in the 14th inning. One out. Cubs nursing a one-run lead. The pitch. Ground ball to Lecoq. He has it. Tosses it to Frailing. Two outs. Mercer advances to third. It's going to be up to Reitz. There is Bill Rigney, who stands in that corner of that dugout. There's Mercer on third base, 90 feet away from tying up this ball game. Cubs are not paying any attention to anybody but Reitz. Frailing on the mound. Mercer, trying to make him balk, makes that break towards home. There's Mercer getting his lead. Frailing is ready. First pitch to Reitz. Swing and a tap in front of the plate. Frailing has it. Turns, throws. Pops it. 6-5 in 14 innings. Cubs with 6 runs, 14 hits. Giants 5 runs, 15 hits.
That a boy, Goody. Nice going. All right, back with a recap in just a moment.
Well, good evening, everybody. My name is Mike. I'm one of the pastors here at Sarasota Alliance Church, and we want to welcome you tonight and thank you so much for coming to this service. As you can already see, Ken Frailing touched a ton of people with his life, and we are all here to celebrate that life together today. We do want to, again, a couple quick reminders for you. If everybody could just take your phone out of your pocket right now and silence it for us, that would be a huge, huge help so that we can really focus for the next few minutes and do that together. That would be a big help. And once again, we are going to have some people that are still coming in the room. So if there is room in the middle of your aisle and you can make room by sliding together and opening up those seats at the end of your row for some other people, that would be a big help as well. We'll keep bringing in chairs as we need to, but whatever you can do to help. Like many of you, I knew Ken for 20 years and in a lot of different ways. And Ken was a friend of mine. Ken was a mentor to me. Ken taught me a lot about a lot of different things in my life. And we got to spend a lot of different times together. And one of the things that Diane asked tonight is that a lot of us try to wear sports shirts and different things. So I wore my Rays shirt tonight, and here's the reason why. Ken used to take me to Rays games every now and then. And when he took me, he always got free tickets thanks to MLBPA. And I always felt like a real big shot walking in that place with Ken. Like, I'm getting the free tickets from the ex-major leaguer that's given me. Like, I just felt like a huge, huge deal walking in that place with him. But I just treasured those memories with Ken and spending that time with him. Tonight we have the opportunity to do many different things. Tonight we remember. We remember Ken's life. We remember his extraordinary impact in the lives of people. Tonight we mourn. And we don't want to brush past that. We understand that when we lose somebody, there is a loss. And we don't want to just act like that isn't there. We don't want to ignore that. We acknowledge that there is loss whenever we lose somebody, especially like a Ken Frailing. But more than anything else, tonight we want to celebrate. When we met with Diane and Nikki and Ryan a few days ago, they said, we want tonight to be a celebration of Ken's life. And if you knew Ken Frailing, and if you knew his faith in Jesus, you know that he would want us to be celebrating tonight. Because right now he is standing in the presence of his Savior. He is with Jesus. He is more excited now than he has ever been standing on a ball field or on a golf course or anywhere else that he stood on in his lifetime. He is more excited and more celebratory right now. And so that's what he wants us to do tonight too, is celebrate. It's yes to remember, yes to mourn, but to celebrate his life. And so we're going to do that in a number of different ways tonight. You're going to hear from some different people who are close to Ken. We're going to sing together, and we're going to hear from God's word together. And through it all, we're going to remember, and we're going to celebrate. But before we do any of that, I want to pray. And I just want to ask God to meet us here tonight. I want to ask God to encourage us tonight. I want to ask God to comfort us tonight as we remember Ken's life. So would you bow with me as we pray? God, you are good. And even when we experience a loss, even when we lose a friend like Ken Frailing, sometimes it's hard to say that statement and mean it, but God, we want to mean that statement tonight, that you are good. God, we trust you, we love you, we thank you that we get to be in this room all together, remembering a person that was so important and so big in all of our lives. God, we love Ken. We love the example that he lived. We love the legacy that he left. We love his family that he helped create and mold and develop into people who love you as well. And God, tonight as we celebrate, as we remember, as we mourn, meet us here, Father. May your spirit fill our hearts. May your spirit encourage us. May your spirit give us peace as we gather tonight. We continue to pray for Ken's family, for Diane, that you would give her extraordinary strength and comfort in this time, for his kids, for his grandkids, for his extended family, that you would continue to comfort them in these coming days. So God, as we get ready to celebrate and remember, meet us here tonight. Father, we love you, and we thank you. In your name we pray, amen. So like I said, you get to hear from some people tonight, some people that were very, very close to Ken. We're gonna hear from Nikki, and we're gonna hear from some of his grandkids. We're gonna hear from Ryan, and we're going to hear from his brother-in-law, Dan, family members who were deeply impacted by the life of Ken Frailing. And then after that, we're going to sing and we're going to hear God's word. But let's just take these next few moments as the family comes and remember Ken's life.
I just wanted to take a minute to just look and see who's all here. Would you take some pictures, please? Of everybody. I really do want to remember this because it's just so hard to sum up words to describe my dad. All week long, I've been really praying and thinking about what I wanted to say today. And it really wasn't until this morning, as I was taking the dogs for a walk, and I was actually on my phone watching post-game video from Riley's first college football game last night, and I was scrolling through my phone and looking at pictures from Brody's football game last night, and my first inclination was, hey Siri, call Papa. Oh no, we're not gonna call Papa right now. And that is what I did every morning after one of the kids' games. We would talk on the phone and we would discuss how the boys did and how proud we were of them and all their accomplishments, and we just couldn't wait to see them fulfill their dreams of going to the NFL. And it's those moments that make me sad, knowing I'm not going to have those conversations anymore with him. And even though those conversations were from father to daughter, they were also athlete to athlete. And with me being a jock in high school and growing up with a professional athlete as a dad, you can pretty much imagine everything we did turned into competition. Whether it was, one of the things I remember is we would go across the street, my brother and I, and we would each have our glove, and he would just throw these pop flies up, and we would have to call each other off, and whoever got the most, you know, won. And we didn't win anything, but it was about winning. And we would have competitions about who could run around the block the fastest, and who could jump rope without messing up. And another competition we had that is probably, it's precious to me, but it might make you guys either laugh or cringe, I'm not sure, was our spitting competition. So, as a ball player, you can imagine my dad always would spit. And after a while, I was like, you gotta teach me how to do that. And listen, by the time I got to high school, I could outspit any boy anywhere around. And my kids can probably agree, I can still do it if I... but the one competition that I never did win was when it came to my kids. And when we would get on the phone and talk about one of the kids' games, like we would have this morning, we would literally compete back and forth to see who could recall the best plays or what happened, and talk through the play-by-play. And we would try to out-brag each other about my kids. And you guys know he was always the best at bragging about his grandkids. They were so special to him. But even though the competitiveness brings such good memories, I mean, I can go on and on, it's really his legacy that he left that will live on forever. I'm not sure if you guys know, but my dad actually loved writing notes. And when I went off to college, he would write me every single week. I would get a letter in the mail. And I think he did the same for you, Ryan, didn't he? And he would always send me Bible verses. He would send me words of encouragement. He would always talk to me about FCA, which is the Fellowship of Christian Athletes, which I was involved in high school. And he was like, you got to go find the FCA at college, because those are going to be the kids that you want to spend time with. They're the ones that are going to have the good values. And he was always sharing those things with me. And then once I had kids, he started writing notes to them. And with the power of texting, it actually became a daily tradition with my boys. And he didn't just text to say hi. He would check in with them daily to see how they were doing physically, emotionally, but most importantly, Pop wanted my kids to know Jesus and to be sure that they would be spending eternity in heaven. And he would send them words of encouragement and Bible verses. He would tell them how to act on the field, how to be godly men, and how to be godly athletes. He taught them biblical principles. At the time he did that, he always would include some sort of a funny story so the kids would remember it. And this morning, when I was actually, or I guess it was a couple days ago, I was going through some papers, and I immediately noticed his handwriting. And so I pulled this card out, and I thought this was completely fitting to read. And this is, which I recognized it because he wrote this exact card to Riley, and I'm pretty sure he wrote this to you, Brody. And I'm not sure if he wrote it to Charlotte yet. But it says, "Stuff of which champions are made." And then there's an acronym of the word champion, or champions, and it says courage, honesty, ambition, maturity, and then in parentheses he wrote manliness. Then the P stands for patience and practice. The I stands for interest. The O stands for obedience. The N stands for nerve or guts, as he put it. And then the S stands for sacrifice. And then he wrote this verse, and I thought this was just totally fitting to read today. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown championship of life. Revelation 2:10. And I just picture my dad wearing that crown right now. And mom took their part very seriously when we dedicated my kids to the Lord at this very church on this very stage. He and my mom both has been my spiritual true like North Star, and that they became that for my children too. And once my kids all asked Jesus into their hearts, they were both there to witness my kids' baptisms. But we never had to wonder how my dad felt. He told us all of the time, and I appreciated that. I can't even tell you. I mean, every single time we got on a phone call, he ended it with, I love you. And if we were in person, he would always say, I love you, and give you a big hug. And for Charlotte and I, he would always reach out and he would pucker his lips so his whiskers wouldn't prick us, and he would give us a quick little peck on the lips. And I was thinking through that this morning, and I just imagined him doing that. And I was able to do that. I'm very thankful on Wednesday when I saw him the day before. And, you know, I honestly do have the best memories growing up. But I even have something more special, and it's recalling the memories he's created with my children. So pop up in memory of you. We're just going to rub some dirt on it and get back out there living for Jesus and making you proud. One thing that we have for everyone, and we didn't have them out front because we wanted to just personally hand them to you when you come through to the CLC afterwards. We, you know, invite you guys to come over for some fellowship and some food and give us all hugs and tell us your funny stories, because we want to hear your stories about my dad. And we made a special card for you, so make sure you find that and take that home with you today. I know my kids. Do you want to read it? Okay, so Charlotte's going to say something first. Oh, you want me to read it? Oh, good. She's making me read this. Come here. Most people have a normal grandpa. I had a pop-up. Pop-up would take me to work at Uncle Ryan's every weekend, and afterwards we would always go to Panera. Pop-up would always buy double chocolate Klondike bars, and we would eat them together watching golf. Pop-up would always tell me funny little jokes. For example, what do you call a laughing motorcycle? A Yamaha-ha-ha. Pop-up had the best and happiest life. If you ever saw him, he was always smiling. Pop-up was the best grandpa you could ask for. Love you.
I just had my first college game last night, and I was waiting for that phone call after the game. You know, he'd always call me, but I know he was there with me all night, and I just flew in from Nashville about a few hours ago so I could be here and spend time with all you guys. And I don't know if I'm going to get through this, but I'm going to try. And it's what he meant in my life, and just the little things I remember about him. It's just, Pop-up was the man I looked up to all my life because he played in the MLB, raised an amazing family, and most of all, how close he was with Jesus. Pop-up has made me the man I am today spiritually and the leader I am, and I'm so blessed for that. Him and Nana have made me so strong with my connection with God and would answer all the questions I had about the Bible. But the past month, I I've been closer to God than I've ever been. I can tell God's been testing my faith, and I get very upset with him and say, why would you do that? But I have to come to realize that God does everything for a reason, whether it's breaking up with a loved one or it being time to go. As much as I dislike it, God has a reasoning for it. I know Pop-Up. He's looking down on me and watching me strive on the field. While saying that, last night when I got to play my first college snaps, and it was truly something special, and I felt Pop-Up there in my presence or next to me on the field. I know how proud he would be with how I've been performing on and off the field, and I'm really going to miss him. But he was such a great grandpa, and the memories we made together, like, he let me drive a brand new Lexus when I was 14 years old. He would always tell me crazy stories about when he was in the league, and he just teached me the ways of the game and how it was made. I mean, he taught me how to throw football. He would always talk about how great the Packers are and how they're going to sweep everybody in the playoffs and win the Super Bowl every year. Which in my head, I thought he was crazy. He taught me how to golf. He'd always throw the ball with me, Charlotte and Brody in the pool. Whenever I'd go over on the weekend, he'd take me out to eat anywhere I'd want. And the little things I noticed, like just the texts he'd send me every day and the candy bars he'd hide in the fridge. But in all truly, he did love me and everyone else with all his heart. And I know he's in a better place up there, hanging with Jesus, just chatting it up. I'm going to miss him, but I'll make him proud and carry on. And carry on his legacy for as long as I live.
Well, that should be easy to follow. Goodness. Couple quick observations or thoughts here. I've done some crazy stuff with me over 20 years, and today's the first day they're going to see me cry, so just deal with that. The second is, you know, this is a funeral and not a sporting event because the seats are free and there's a whole front row empty. So it's... But it's always a challenge if somebody dies that we love that we didn't expect. When you have a little forewarning, it's just easier to say goodbye. Well, what we're going to do is something a little different. On the cards you're going to hand out is my dad's cell phone number. I rehearsed this, I didn't cry once, so it's not going to happen here. But if you had something you had left to say to my dad, feel free to text him. And it says, direct line to Ken, which isn't the exact truth, because you have to look up and say, hey, Ken, start talking. That's the direct line to Ken. But if you have a story you'd like to share with my mom or the kids about my dad, feel free to text him. We're going to leave his phone on for until his text stopped coming in. So this week, I was in New Mexico when I got the call. My dad died. This has been that was a day I think I had prepared for and dreaded my entire adult life. I knew if I didn't prepare, I wouldn't make it. So this week I'd have a rough moment and I'd think, you know, what's Dad doing in heaven right now? It's my dad, so it's probably something a little nutty, but I think the first thing he did, if you know his baseball career, he was a junk ball pitcher. His fastball was 90 miles an hour. So I think he found the first baseball diamond, picked up a ball, went out and threw it, first 100 plus mile an hour fastball. So that's about right, and walked off. He went and found the nearest angel and said, please direct me to the closest first tee box. I want to see what the heavenly golf courses look like. Heaven is probably only something we can't comprehend with our earthly minds, but I think if it's anything like this, I think that's probably my dad right now. So, I've had a lot of ups and downs this week, and one of the big challenges for me was how does a son sum up his dad's life in a few minutes? I thought about telling stories or jokes that he would like and things he told in the past, but that didn't set with me. So it's also a challenge because, as Nikki and the family described, that my dad reached so many people during his life that I think it'd almost be impossible to sum it up in just a few minutes. So I was going back and forth and just ultimately concluded that I don't need to try and sum up my dad's life because you all know it. You lived it with him. You got to experience it for yourself. And he might be the only guy, or at least one of very few, that doesn't require any embellishment when you're talking about the life he lived. So I figured I'd just leave that to your memories and stories that we can tell each other in the future. I'm sure there are things I have no idea about my dad that I'd welcome for you to tell me. So I had a lot of discoveries about myself, I think, this week, and how I would take it. You don't know until it happens, like a lot of things. And it might sound strange from a guy who just lost his dad, but even last Thursday, I'm driving through New Mexico back 7 hours to an airport to come home, and I had a great deal of peace kind of wash over me, and it hasn't left. I'm sad, but when I try to think, what is this? I was happy, and I think that I feel like I'm the happiest guy on earth. Because I got to spend 45 years with Ken Frailing as my dad. There are people in this room that I know that didn't have anything close like that growing up and thought and wished that my parents were theirs. I mean, if that's not an amazing testament to your parents and the relationship that you had. And second, and probably most importantly, is I know where my dad's at. I knew the second my mom called. It was amazing. She is just an absolute rock. If you talk about living what you believe to the very end, you don't have to look any further. So I know today I've, one shot at paying a tribute to my dad. So I said, all right, what would dad want? And how do I do it best? So what does my dad love most in life? That's where I started. Well, that's a pretty simple answer. You all know him, he was an athlete. He loved sports. He loved my mom. My sister Nikki, my brother Sean, the grandkids. And that's what really gave him his glow, was his grandkids. Nothing made him glow like grandkids. Those are the things he loved more on earth than anything. But it wasn't what he loved most. When you think about my dad and you wonder why you feel about my dad the way you do, it's because of his relationship with Jesus Christ. Period. His relationship is what gave him his ultimate joy and peace in life, to live the life the way he did. So as the week went on, it became clear that my job not to stand up here and reminisce and tell, a story-filled eulogy that we can all just remember and smile about and not think about again, but to take the opportunity to do the one thing that's more important to my dad than anything. He loved sports, but his goal in life was not to fill up, dugouts and sidelines with pro athletes. His idea was to fill up the walls of heaven with as many souls as possible from the message he could tell, and if he couldn't talk to you, you saw it through the way he lived his life. I'm going to say it's going to get tough, but you're already seeing it, so that was the message I have to deliver. Well, if you're going to deliver it, you have to believe it, and I do, but I've also fallen short in that in my personal life. In this room, just support me, I can see my friends, a lot of cops I used to work with, guys I love, guys I risked my life with, and they risked their life for me. Some of the toughest men in the world sit in this room. Well, if I've never shared my faith with you, I apologize to you, but you're going to hear it today. What gave my dad peace was a complete knowledge that when the day came for him to die, he wasn't afraid because he knew he'd instantly be in heaven. If any of you knew my dad, he never lived a life of fear. He wasn't afraid of anything. It's not because he was my dad. I just can't think of any time that I saw him afraid. I saw him cry, I think, three times in my life. When his mom died, when his dad died, and when his sister died. That's it. He lived a joyful life. He did not live a life of fear, and he definitely instilled that in his kids and grandkids. He taught us to be tough, and I'm not sure I'm making the best example up here when you guys held yourself together, and I'm a basket case. But the reason he wasn't afraid was not because he was a tough man. It's because he accepted Jesus in his heart as his Lord and Savior. He believed that Jesus died on the cross for our sins, and that was it. He's going to heaven, and that's all anyone has to do. I was doing the math today. It's been 25 years since I stood in a church behind a podium, so I'm a little rusty. I certainly don't remember crying as much. The story of salvation is a simple one. I just told you how it works. I'm sure, keeping with the baseball theme, the pastor's going to come up and bat cleanup on it. If you feel God talking to you in this room, doesn't matter who you are, and you're not saved, and you want to learn more, at the end, when we're in the back celebrating my dad's life, there's going to be plenty of people to talk to. So, me included. Come see me, please. And if you love my dad, the best way to keep the memory of him going is do just that. Live the way my dad lived. Practice what you preach. Smile at everybody. Don't have an enemy in the world. Again, all things I fail short on. More kids in this world, I think it will be a better world. I'm almost done. The last gift that God gave to my dad on earth was a wonderful and peaceful end. That matters to a son. If you don't know, last Thursday, he went and sat in his favorite chair, watched golf. He's going to take a nap before we went to Brody's football game. Gently put his arms down the armrest, laid his head back, went to sleep, and God said, "Time to go. Come home." That was it. Didn't struggle. He died peacefully in his sleep because of his faith. I told you he wasn't a man who was afraid, but that faith was equally shared with my mom. She is an absolute. My dad lived a great life. My mom, when she found him in his chair, she could have reacted in many different ways. But she chose to live by faith. So instead of crying or saying, "No, God, why?" or "I want him back," she reached out. Gently put her hands on his face and said, "Ken, are you with Jesus?" And when he didn't answer, she knew. So, if you're here and you're missing that comfort in your life where if you were to die tonight or a loved one were to die tonight and you don't know where you're going or where they're going, you can find the answer. You can have that peace today. So when you go to sleep tonight, if you close your eyes tonight and don't wake up, you'll know where you're going, where the loved one's going. Because the only thing worse, I think, this week than my dad dying is not knowing where he would be, and that I almost can't take. So, just lastly, my dad, I look around this room, my dad truly loved this place. He loved all of you. I mean, church was home. You know, this was, if he wasn't at home, he was at church or the golf course. But this was it. He loved everybody here. And I've never met the new pastor in person. He was sick on Monday, so we were talking through Zoom. But I know my dad loves you, and he talks so highly of you, and was so excited for the future of this church and the people in it. So just thank you very much, and I look forward to hearing some stories I don't know about my dad later on tonight. Thank you.
I guess I'm the closer. Yeah. It hit me like one of Ken's massive drives right here. You know, it's the phone call you never want to receive. It's something I was totally unprepared for. But when I hung up with my sister Diane, I couldn't help but be grateful of how God uses us to orchestrate his plans. You see, Diane and Ken were planning to arrive at our house in Wisconsin for about 2 weeks this Sunday. And we were so excited to have them for a longer span of time than usual. And although Ken is my brother-in-law, he's the brother I never had. He was definitely a man I was looking forward to growing old with. So this is not a eulogy, but an example of how God weaves our lives together. We're all individual threads that God uses along with his grace and his mercy and his love to build a beautiful tapestry. We are all threads in this story, and we all have one common thread that has brought us here today, and that thread is Ken Frailing. Ken grew up across the street from my wife Beth in the little town of Marion, Wisconsin, population 1,200. So she knew Ken before I did. Her dad happens to be John Bartelt, Ken's baseball coach, since Ken could throw a baseball. Ken was like another son to Coach Bartelt. John saw something special in Ken, and the two spent many hours working on Ken's craft. He coached him in Little League and junior high and high school. He sat beside him when he signed his contract with the Chicago White Sox as a senior in high school. John went on to coach for 43 years, and Ken became the most successful athlete to ever come out of Marion. And now at age 93, Coach mourns the loss of his favorite pupil along with all of us. My wife Beth had her first motorcycle ride on the back of Ken's motor scooter, a 90cc Bridgestone that I would later purchase from Ken's sister and brother-in-law for $25 when I had my paper out. I would see it in the garage when I'd deliver their paper. I had no idea it was Ken's. I didn't know he ever had a motorcycle. It didn't run anymore. The Kickstarter was broke. But it was there that I began to learn to be a motorcycle mechanic, another thread in the tapestry. I first met Ken and 1967 when I was 11. He was pursuing my older sister, and of course, I was the annoying little brother. Fast forward 9 years to the spring of 1976. I was on my way home from Austin, Texas, where I was trying to figure out what to do with my life a year after high school. I spent a couple days with Diane and Ken. He was pitching for the Chicago Cubs. He took me to Wrigley, and I met the Cubs athletic trainer, Gary Nicholson. It's the first time I ever heard of an athletic trainer. But that began to shape my career. 3 years later, I was sending letters to the Chicago Cubs and the Chicago White Sox using Ken's name and his stellar reputation in hopes that they would even acknowledge me. But they did. Dave Dombrowski called me, and I spent the next two seasons with the Chicago White Sox. Of course, that meant I spent the next two spring trainings down here in Sarasota with Ken and Diane. We spent evenings talking about baseball, but also talking about Jesus Christ and who he was. I would go to the Catholic Church on Saturday night, and I'd go to Venice Bible Church with them on Sunday. That was the first year. By the second year, I'd accepted Jesus Christ as my personal Savior, and I would not only attend church services with him on Sunday, but Ken would hold a Bible study for a lot of the players that were down here for spring training on Wednesday night when he was with the Royals, and I'd go to those. Diane and Ken would go on to become Beth and my spiritual mentors for years to come, a very colorful thread being added to that tapestry. By observing Diane and Ken's life, we saw how they served others, how they prayed with and for others, how they supported those around them within their circle. It's from them that we learned what the Bible teaches us about tithing. And again, they were our mentors for tithing. They taught us about going beyond their immediate circle and reaching out to others in the community and by supporting missionaries abroad. We watched how they raised Nikki and Ryan, and that influenced us as we later would raise our three. We read books that they read, and we discussed the men's and women's Bible studies that they were in and that we were in for the past 30 years. I'm sure many of you in this room can relate to ways Diane and Ken have added threads like this in your own tapestry. In 1978, Beth and I spent our first spring break in Sarasota with Diane and Ken. We weren't married yet, and the only reason Coach let us come is because we were staying at the house of Ken Frailing. As we raised our kids, we would often share stories of Diane and Ken's servant hearts. As our family grew, we would come down to visit, and Uncle Kenny would always wake one of them up early, make a donut run with them when they're in their PJs. And he'd always share lots of stories with them. When we were older, in the maybe junior high, senior high ages, he would always use the two fingers, like, I'm watching you, to our two daughters. And he would share stories with them. When they went off to college, each of our three kids were able to come down for a week with some of their closest friends during their college spring break. It has become one of the highlights of their college years. And if you can believe it, Ken would share stories with them. Even 2 weeks ago, our son-in-law, Isaac, was talking with Ken about the time he batted against Nolan Ryan. He actually did. Ken was pretty proud about the fact that as most of his teammates were striking out, Nolan's pitch happened to hit Ken's bat for a ground out at first. Ken and I share a love for golf. Actually, he loves golf and he's good at it. I just love to golf with Ken, that's all. When we played together, we would often use a money ball to putt with this guy. We would joke about the million-dollar putt that we were about to make like we were professional golfers. I think I'm going to drive it in the ocean before I leave. And no, Ken, you don't need to go look for it. He's going to find it anyway. He was such a ball hound. So I bought a new one. It's got stars on it, because Ken, you're my star. And I wore the shirt today from the time we played at Legends Golf Course in Orlando, because Ken's my legend. We also had a tradition where we would give a gift to each other when we'd come here or he'd come up there. And I think in 40 years, I never bought a pair of golf shoes because he always kept me well supplied. I would typically look for a t-shirt, something from one of the Wisconsin sports teams. So I had this one ready for Sunday. But Ryan, you know in sports, when a guy goes down, you say, next man up. So this is yours, guy. Your dad was always proud of the watches you gave him. He would always show those to me, and it reminded me of something Jill Briscoe recently penned after losing her longtime husband, Pastor Stuart Briscoe, last month. She said, when you know Jesus, you let him wind your clock. And when it stops, he gives you new one with everlasting springs. Thank you.
If the team could come out, that'd be great. My name's Scott. I'm also here on staff. This is such a privilege to be a part of this, to be in a room that's filled with this many people. I think a lot of us have probably been to funerals and memorial services and not seen rooms filled like this. It's something to behold. speaks more of the person and the reason we're here. As we were planning this service, just a few songs that Diane, we were talking about, what, you know, what do we sing and where do we go in terms of the service? And one of the songs is, it's called Word of God Speak. And it's just a song that, it's just pretty raw. It's written by a band, Mercy Me. It's a guy that's just, he's writing it, and life was hard, and he didn't know what to do. And so he was just coming to the Word and saying, I need this Word to speak to me. And there's all kinds of things God says in His Word. His Word says He's near to the brokenhearted, and He saves those who are crushed in spirit. His Word says, I'm the resurrection and the life, and anyone who believes in me will live even though he dies. His Word says how precious in the sight of God is the death of His saints. His Word says that even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I won't fear evil. And His staff, they comfort me. His Word says, since you've been raised with Christ, those who have placed their trust in Him, Jesus says, set your heart on things above where I'm seated, at the right hand of my Father. Romans 8 says, I'm convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor the things present, things to come, nor powers, not height, not depth, nor anything else, that all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. At a loss for words, in the funny things, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God to speak. In the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, all that I need is to be with you. And in the quiet, hear your voice, Word of God speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay. Still and know that you're in this place.
your holiness, word of God, speak. Passage you may be a bit mystified about, but I think it'll make sense. These are the names of the mighty men whom King David had. Josheb, he was the chief of the three of the mighty men. He wielded his spear against 800 whom he killed. Next to him, the three mighty men, was Eleazar. He was with David when they defied the Philistines who were gathered there for battle, and the men of Israel ran, and he ran down to the Philistines and fought them till his hand was weary. His hand clung to the sword. It was frozen. And the Lord brought about a great victory that day. And the men returned after him only to strip the slain. The next was Shema. The Philistines gathered together at Lehi, and there was a plot of ground full of flowers, and the men fled from the Philistines. But not Shema. He took his stand in the midst of the ground and the flowers and defended it and struck down the Philistines, and the Lord worked a great victory. This is a chapter in 2 Samuel 23 called David's Mighty Men. King David was the second king in Israel. Now, there was one right before him, Saul, didn't go too well. King David comes in, takes this small nation, and God uses him to build an empire. And this chapter is the chapter of the mighty men of David, who were famous warriors, men who didn't shrink back, who didn't run away, but ran towards conflict, ran towards the battle, and refused to quit. And God used these men often to turn the battle, turn the tide of wars. Fierce men, filled with drive, filled with resolve. I think all of us know Ken is cut from a different cloth. I've known him just a couple months, and just the stories that he's telling me, and then the stories I'm hearing, he's cut from a different cloth. He just was. Hearing the stories, as Jimmy was talking about, some of these, even in high school, coming out of high school, most people who followed high school athletics would know who Ken was as a senior in high school. He lit up the basketball court, just ripped it up. Most people don't know that. And then he goes on and gets drafted in baseball, major leagues. Goes on to be this pitcher that gets nominated for the All-Star team, 1975. He's on the All-Star team. I don't know how many professional athletes you know. I know two that would actually say they know me. And now I only know one. How many do you know that know you and would claim you, right? Like, it's rare. It's rarefied air. Like, we're in the presence of somebody who's one of the greats, who rose to such a level that it's breathtaking. How do you get to be that good? How do you get to be that great? You know, the story goes on, and there's this crazy story. There's three guys out of the 30. And it was harvest time, and they were in battle, and the Philistines were across the valley, and David was—he wasn't really in a nice place. It was a garrison at best, right? And it's on the front lines, and it's war, and David's just talking out loud. King David, oh man, I wish I could have some of that water from the well of Bethlehem. You guys know what I'm talking about. Well, the problem is the Philistines had Bethlehem, and then there's just three mighty men who heard that. Broke through the camp of the Philistines, drew out water at the well of Bethlehem, carried it back through the lines of the Philistines, and brought it to David. And David took it, and in front of all the men, he poured it out. And he said, "Far be it from me to ever drink this water. I will never, ever call my men to do something like that. Only God could call someone to do that." And the men loved him for it. I think the three were probably ticked. But I think Ken would probably be one of those guys. Because he'd just go, "Well, you do it." Right? You do it. The king wants it. You do it. Very clear. You know, you fast forward about 900 years, and Jesus is hanging out with his disciples, and the disciples go to this question, who's the greatest in the kingdom? I don't know why dudes do this, but we do this. ESPN, that's all they talk about is the list, right? Who's the greatest? Who's the GOAT? Who's the best? Who's the top 10? We're forever doing this, trying to find out who's the greatest. And Jesus, in that moment, turns it upside down. He says, oh, I'll tell you who's the greatest. You're going to find greatness when you descend. You're going to descend into greatness. The greatest in the kingdom of God are the ones that give themselves away. The greatest in the kingdom of the gods are the ones who serve, who sacrifice, who do the hidden things, who don't look for the recognition, but just look for the hurting and the broken and the lost and the ones that are left out and the ones that are missed, and they give themselves away. You know, if you read the little bio, that piece of paper coming in, there's a story about Ken's journey spiritually, and I'm sure if you came here today and you didn't think Jesus would be talked about, you didn't know Ken. Like, there's just no way you're not going to get through a service that doesn't mention Jesus. And that bio talks about this journey of him and just, you know, getting injured and just almost losing everything. And it was at a conference for Christian professional athletes over in Orlando that he was invited, tried to get out of it, and the chaplain from the Bucks wouldn't let him get out of it, weasel out of it, so he had to go, and him and Diane went. And towards the course of the week, they get to this one session that's towards the end, and this guy just starts talking about a personal relationship with God. And what's interesting is in the middle of that, Diane's on her own journey. And 6 months earlier, she comes from, you may know this, she comes from a Catholic background. She shared this with our church a few weeks ago. Comes from a Catholic background, and the most frustrating thing for her was the whole pressure to do works and do works and perform and do works, and yet you just never knew if it would ever be enough. And you could never know if it was enough. And I mean, Catholics got it, Baptists got a good thing going, they got that whole performance thing going, Lutherans got it, Catholics aren't the only ones out there, right? But that was this journey, and how is it that, I think the struggle was, how is it that if I'm supposed to be connected to the most loving being and the most powerful being in the world, why do I feel like I'm not? And why am I trapped in performance that I can never really actually meet up to? I don't know if that's your story or not. And that was hers. And she came to a point where she realized, just like Ryan was saying, it's about a relationship with Christ. And so they're sitting in the middle of this seminar, and this guy's saying, hey, I want you just to think about, and he's talking about Jesus and this whole relationship with Jesus. And he says, hey, I just want you to think about when you maybe made that decision. And Diane just leans over and touches him and says, I made that decision 6 months ago. And Ken at that point wasn't a Christian. Well, actually, no, he said this. He goes, well, he says, it's easier for me to remember. I just did it 30 seconds ago. He came to a point where he needed Christ. You know, the Bible says we all fall short. I mean, that's a common experience. No one's perfect. I mean, everybody says it. No one's perfect. It's like we innately know that. But it's not just about this idea of, okay, so we're not perfect, but according to what standard? And that's really what our spirits are wondering about, right? If we all know we're not perfect, who told us that? And it's something we innately know, and it's us bumping up against the divine. And what Christ came and did is he came here to live this perfect life we couldn't. And then he dies on the cross. He's raised from the grave. And on that cross, he took our sin, and he took the punishment, all the guilt, everything, paid all of that, the death penalty that we deserved. And he did that because we know we'll never be good enough, and we'll always fall short every time. The Bible says we fall short all the time. And yet Christ has come, and if you believe in me and trust in me and what I'm offering for salvation, I'll take that away. But it's not just what he takes away from us, it's also what he gives us. He gives us a life filled with hope. He gives us a life filled with joy. And he gives us a calling to live for. See, Ken, the reason you're all here was given, he proved he could do the greatness of man. He made the all-star team. But then God gave him a calling and said, I got something that's even better. I want you to become my mighty man for me, for King Jesus. And what we saw was Ken, right? All the stories you know about the greatness of Ken. He's vacuuming. Like, Ken vacuums floors here at the church. He gets coffee ready. He cleans up the coffee. He pulls an awkward person into his life. He buys donuts for strangers. He puts his arm around people that are upset. He goes and he prays for businessmen. He goes and takes leftover donuts with Jimmy, and they go down to businesses that random businesses, hey, you're now the business of the month, and they give him the leftover donuts. I mean, that's just him and Jimmy. Like, it's him and Jimmy. Jimmy's got to be part of this, right? Like, pour into your grandkids. That's him. Cherish your wife. Show grace. Pull people in. Anything for the king. Boom, you got to do it. You got to do it. You know, often people talk about how great people are, right? Men or women. But the real question you want to know is, what does their family say? The real test of greatness is not what's necessarily out there. It's also what happens at home. And how many times do you see great men and women who don't have the family that stands up on the stage and says, this man is great at home. This man loved his family well. What we just saw here, folks, is rare. Tragically. You know, I wonder where you are tonight. I wonder how many of you may be fighting God. You've been running from this moment. A moment in time like what happened with Ken and Diane back in the 70s. And maybe you're just realizing you've just run into God tonight. I know it's not fair. He's the hound of heaven. He's after you. He just is. And he's been chasing you, not to judge you, but to save you. He's been after you not to make you pay, but to tell you, I've paid for it. You can have grace. You can have mercy. C.S. Lewis once wrote, God whispers to us in our pleasures. He speaks to us in our consciences, but he shouts in our pains. It's his megaphone to rouse a deaf. It's his megaphone to rouse a deaf world. Don't waste his pain. If you feel like God's saying, wake up. Don't waste this. I think Ken right now would want more than anything, if he could be here, he would be saying this. He said it through his kids. He would want his death to be something that is a catalyst for faith in God. Some of you need to wake up. And maybe it's complacency. Some of you have been settling in life, and it's a life that's not of greatness. It's not for him. It's not a life that he would approve of. And he's saying, wake up. That's that shout, right? In the middle of the pain, wake up. Solomon says, look, I'd much rather go to a funeral than a wedding, which is a weird thing to say. Which one would you rather go to, a funeral or wedding? I mean, if it's a good wedding, I mean, you got the band and the line dancing and it's great and everything, right? That's fine. Solomon says, no, I'd much rather go to a funeral. Why? Because you actually talk about things that are real. You actually get to the heart of things and what life is really about. At the wedding, it's just a party. But a funeral, yeah, you start wondering, what am I doing with my life? And maybe tonight is the time. There's a song the band we're going to sing, and as you're maybe hearing from God right now, because I think some of you might be hearing from God. We're going to sing a song, and it's about Jesus. It's about who He is. It's about His power. And I just invite you in the middle of this, if you know Ken and you have this relationship with God, to just soak in this song. And if you're trying to figure that out right now, soak in this song, and maybe God's speaking to you in the middle of this.
Healing. Your name is love. just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
Where you are right now, if you're at a place where you haven't made that decision about Christ, I'd invite you to just speak his name. And you could just simply tell him in your words, I could pray this prayer and it'd be something like this. I just invite you all just to bow your heads and you just do this. Agree with what I'm saying or say it like this to him. It's something like this. Say, Jesus, I need you. I need you. Can't do this life. I know I've got stuff that I'm guilty of. I know I've got things that I've totally missed the mark when it comes to your standard of perfection. Like, I know I'm not perfect, and that means I need forgiveness. I need you to wash it away, and I can't. And I need you. So Jesus, I'm trusting in you right now. I'm believing that you really are God. I'm ready to do it. I'm just gonna say it, Jesus, you're God, and I need you to be my Savior. I need you to take this, all this stuff away. Jesus, would you forgive me? And actually, if you're just saying, it's like, Jesus, look, I'm admitting it. I know I need forgiveness. Then actually, Jesus says, don't say ask for this. He says, actually, just receive it. So you can just say right now, Jesus, okay, I'm receiving your forgiveness. You say I'm forgiven. Then I'm claiming it. Take that away, and Jesus, would you give me something better in return? Would you fill me with you? Would you, like, your presence be in me like it was in Ken? Like, I want that. Like, that irrepressible joy. I want that. I want that hope Ken had. Like, I want that. I want that life like he had. Like, how does he have so much life? That's you, Jesus. Just give me some of it, that life that you gave him. I want that. And if some of you are just, you're brought up short tonight or this past week as you are starting to look at your life, and maybe you need to tell Jesus tonight, it's got to stop. I'm sorry for falling asleep. Sorry. Can't do that anymore. You tell Jesus that. Can't end the service just there, because it ain't over. We're people of hope. We don't grieve. We don't grieve like this world. We grieve with hope. Like, one day this life will be over, and there's another one coming. It's perfect. Song says, I can only imagine. If you know it, sing along. I can only imagine what it will be when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Oh, when all of you be still, will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. When that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun, I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, ever worship you. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Tonight there is a shift in your spirit, and there's something that's happened, and you've made a decision tonight. And I don't know what that is, whether that is saying yes to Christ for the first time or saying yes to Christ like, okay, I gotta wake up and things gotta change. I know this is kind of like way out there, but could you give the gift to this family and just stand where you are? If that's something you did, I know I'm pushing you way out, but that's Kent. So if that's you and you're saying, man, I know whatever that decision is, but you're saying, look, I'm not walking out the same tonight. And maybe that's how you put it. Stand up. Just stand up and let this family know.
Let's stand with this guy. This is an old song. Let's stand with him and not leave this guy alone. Let's sing this song. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King.
No more dying.
No more dying there. We are going to see the King. No more crying there. We are going to see the King. See the King soon. Soon and very soon. Okay, your wife, but let's put it together. I'm going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King.
So we have a lot to celebrate. Even in the midst of our loss, even in the midst of our pain, we have so much to celebrate. And we want to continue to do that with you tonight. In fact, right now, I'm going to go ahead and dismiss the family to go ahead and start heading back towards the back building. As Nikki mentioned, right after we're done here, we would invite all of you to join us in our gym, which is in the building directly behind this one. We'll have some food back there. The family would love to see you, spend some time with you. We're going to give you an opportunity to share your story about Ken and how he impacted your life. And so we want to make sure that you're all invited to stay for that as well. So again, that's going to be happening as soon as we dismiss here in just a moment. We want to let them go first, or else they would never make it to the back building because all of you would surround them. So we're going to let them get back there and get settled for just a minute as we wrap up here. We want to thank you so much for coming tonight and so much for your support of the Frailing family. Obviously, Ken has made a huge impact in your life. And here's the thing. A lot of you have been asking, what can we do for the family? What can we do for the family? Let me tell you what you can do. Here's what you can do. In the next couple of weeks, months, days, whatever, whenever Diane pops into your mind, whenever Ryan pops into your mind, whenever Nikki pops into your mind, a simple text, a call, a hug, all of those things are going to be far more important than a meal, far more important than anything else you could possibly give them, is the fact that you're reaching out to them and showing them that care and compassion. So, whenever they pop in your mind over these next few weeks, make sure you're doing that. Make sure you're keeping them surrounded in that love and care and compassion. Before we go, I'm going to pray, and then we'll dismiss, and you can head back to that back building and join the rest of the family. But let's take a moment and pray. God, we are grateful tonight that we could come and we could celebrate. Yes, we mourn. Yes, we grieve. But as we've talked about, we do not grieve without hope. Father, you are a God that loves us. You are a God that loved Ken Frailing, and Ken loved you. And he showed that to so many of us in so many different ways. And so, God, as we get ready to go out of this room and we remember Ken and we share those memories together, I pray that you would bless us, that you would encourage us because we knew Ken and because he set an example for us. Father, we do continue to pray for the family. Continue to give them peace. Continue to give them comfort. Continue to remind us to love and care for them well over these next few days and weeks and months. God, we love you. We thank you that we could gather together this evening. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. So thanks again for joining us. We invite all of you to join us in the back building. Thank you.